Hi everyone, it's Sean. If this is your first time checking out my YouTube channel, my name is Sean Berry and I'm a creative professional with over 30 years experience in the business. I'm also creative director and partner of a small boutique agency here in Toronto, Ontario, Canada called Booster Rocket Media, where we do all kinds of cool things like websites, video, animation, graphic design, and logo design. And by the way, logos is what I'm going to talk about today because I have my new premium course up on Udemy called Logo Design Theory and Application Bootcamp. And I encourage all of you to check it out. There's a link in the description below that will give you all the information about the course that you need. And basically, this course covers logo design theory, and I go deep into creative principles. I don't spend any time talking about Illustrator tools. I'm not, you know, going to show you, oh, this is how you create a box, and this is how you create a point, and you put it, you know, I'm not going to do any of that stuff. I'm going to cover all creative concept and development type topics. I talk a little bit about vectors, and I talk a little bit about building shapes, but none of it is really a walkthrough of Illustrator or some kind of vector tutorial. So you'll see if you check it out. But anyway, so I decided what I would do in the meantime is I would give you one of the videos here on YouTube so you kind of get a flavor of what the course is all about. I'm pretty proud of it. It was a ton of work to prepare, and there's a lot of work that went into it. And it was also based on a real project too, by the way. I had a real brief, a real client, a real deadline, and these are the real logos that I created. And so anyway, check out this video and then check out the course on Udemy if it looks interesting to you. So hopefully you like this video and check it out. Okay, so the style guide. Every logo that is ever designed for a national brand or for any sort of enterprise or corporate client typically has a style guide. The style guide, as I mentioned in the previous video lesson, is directions off a desert island. What should you do with the logo? What shouldn't you do? And this is somebody that you don't know and you're never going to be able to speak to. You're going to basically provide this document that hopefully will answer most of their questions, and then common sense should answer the rest. So it doesn't have to be such a complicated document that you're trying to think of every possible variation of this logo. You have to somewhat trust, A, that your client respects the brand that you've developed with their cooperation. In my case, John, I have to, you know, expect that he appreciates the brand and will do his best to monitor how things are printed. Maybe I see things once in a while if he shares them with me and I can comment on it. But otherwise, I can't expect that. So what I do is I give this to John and say, here's your package. Here is your equipment in order to keep your logo and your brand on track and used properly, no matter who you send this work to. So that's really what this document has to cover off, is it has to be a good expression of the brand that any graphic designer with common sense could apply to 10 other situations than the ones that we've documented. Because those documented situations give that other person the basic idea, don't do this, but do that, this is okay, and you probably shouldn't do it this way. That gives them all the tools they need. But let's be as comprehensive as we can without going crazy, and we'll just get into it and I'll show you what I'm talking about. It'll be obvious when we go through it. I'm going to pop over to this file, which happens to be my logo style guide. Now I've built it in Illustrator, but I'm going to pop over to the Adobe Acrobat file and just take you through the PDF. It'll be a little easier to read, but I just wanted to show you that I had created this in Illustrator in this way. And let's have a look at the actual document now. Okay, so here in Adobe Acrobat, we have our style guide. Now, essentially the style guide is your directions off a desert island for the next person who's going to work with your logo. So this is a document that is relatively important. You're going to be able to give somebody else a lot of information about the journey that they don't have to go back and ask the client 100 questions, nor do they have to send you several emails. They may still do that from time to time, but you have to understand that other designers will use the material that you create. You can't limit a client to only using you, and you can't limit a client to only use the logo you've designed as long as they do it through you. All of these things are, you know, conditions that are not realistic. So of course, when we give a logo to a client and we've sold it to them, they are going to provide that to printers and other designers to do other types of work. In addition to the logo files that they receive, we're going to give them this PDF document. And this style guide is going to give them information about the logo, the colors, the fonts, and all those things. But we're going to start with a nice welcoming title page as the Greenlight Window Fashions logo style guide, January 2016. Now, the reason that I add a date, and I think you should as well. So adding this date to the style guide is kind of a minor thing, but it's actually a helpful thing. It's saying that as of January 2016, this was the current style guide. And this is helpful if, say, 5 years from now, or even 2 years from now, in my case, John, my client, what if John sends this logo out, I'm no longer available for some reason, and he sends his logo and brand kit to somebody else and says, you know what, we need a refresh. I've worked with this now for a couple of years. Maybe we need to look at this green, or maybe we need to look at this font and make an update. So there's a variety of reasons that these things might happen. So if somebody else updates the logo, or if you do, or if somebody else tweaks the brand, then this style guide has to be adjusted as well, because the style guide will no longer be telling the whole story. So January 2016 lets me know that if this is January 2019, but I know the logo has changed, it might help me to understand I've got an out-of-date style guide. Now that requires that I know all the dates that things changed if I'm an external designer somewhere else. But you know, that's not something that we can ever possibly account for. However, if the client knows and the client understands that, hey, I've changed my brand, but this new designer I've used now twice is using an out-of-date style guide, the date will just solve that problem and answer that question. So throw it in there, it's a good thing to do. Not super necessary, but I think it's really helpful. So what the first thing that I do generally is I will set up the style guide to introduce them to the logo and a little bit of the logo philosophy. This doesn't tell them everything they need to know about the logo, but if they look at it and they like it or don't like it, at least they will understand the principles behind it, or at least what it's trying to communicate. So we're going to give them a little bit of a blurb just so that they understand the journey. Greenlight Window Fashions is a modern business with traditional values. The Greenlight Window Fashions logo shares those traits with distinguished style, modern shapes and typography with an old-fashioned design twist. When using the logo in design application, be sure to follow good design principles and use this style guide as examples of best practice. So we're just going to reassure them about what they are going to receive in this guideline. So in the color break section, what I'm going to do is break this down into the four different color variations, rather, for print. Now the reason I'm not putting the RGB color breakdown on this page is because it's on the following page. This really has to do with print. So when they go through, they'll see that there's actually more information about color, so we don't need to be concerned with that. But we're going to give them this first breakdown so that any printer or any designer doing a print job will know the color basics. So when we flip over now to color palette, we're going to cover off the RGB and hex palette information. On the top right, we have the CMYK color palette. We have our green, we have our complementary blue, our accent yellow, and our rich black information. And we break it down in exactly the same way. But on the very end, I show a 10%, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90 percent tone value block on the right side. This is to remind them that they can use tints of the colors and that they can use tints of black. And we're going to describe that in copy as well to the left, but just quickly we'll finish up on this right side. The spot color palette, we break down the Pantone colors in the same way, and we found a blue and we found a yellow Pantone number that match the numbers that we chose for the color palette, and our one color black, and then our RGB hex information is green, blue, yellow, and black are broken down into their various components for RGB and hex as well, which again, web designers, anyone who working with web files will understand that information and they will appreciate that you supplied that. So on the left side, we're going to give a little bit of a reaffirmation once again. So on the right side, we kind of have the details, but on the left side, we're going to explain in plain English what this all means. So Greenlight Window Fashions color palette is fresh and cool, muted colors with a green influence representing both the art of window fashions and a clear blue sky with warm sunlight breaking through. So that first little paragraph just quickly says, hey, there's a reason we chose these colors. don't throw purple in there because you like purple. This has an idea behind it. For some reason, another designer was given this information and it asked to expand this color palette for some reason that we don't anticipate, then at least they have an idea why these colors were established the way that they are. So it's helpful information is the point. Now, beneath that, we get into a little bit of further description. Green is a primary color that can be used for large blocks of color and important graphics. Blue can be used for secondary elements like headlines and graphics. Yellow is used for accents and highlights. Please also use tints freely, provided they are properly incorporated into the design so not to clash with the primary elements like the logo. Basically, use design discretion. So, logo application backgrounds. This is going to be a quick blurb about how the logo gets used, whether or not it's put against a color, whether they need to make a reverse version of it, or any application that looks similar to what's on the right side, we're going to describe that. Now, you can obviously see that there are four blocks that have an X through them, and the X would seem to indicate that you probably shouldn't do whatever's happening in that particular square. So again, we're going to help them with a little plain language description of that on the left side, and this will just help them see ahead of time what we're really talking about. So Green Light Window Fashion's logo works best on a white background, but can be applied to a color background if necessary. Please refer to the guidelines to the right for examples of what works and does not work. The logo obviously does not work in color against a color background, nor does it work as a black over a dark tone. Do not place the logo over a color not found in the color palette. Make sure there is sufficient contrast between the logo and background when it's necessary to place it over a color or tone background. In the case of a vehicle wrap or t-shirt, the logo can be contained in a white box or used over a shirt or vehicle which is green or white, so long as the logo is readable and there is sufficient contrast. And it's helpful information, even though the limits of this may get stretched by somebody else, at least we've established the rules up front. So safety, when talking about logos, the word safety means a perimeter around the logo of a certain size that you don't allow other elements to get into. So if there was a block of copy next to it, or there's a graphic image to the left or right of the logo in a printed piece or on a website or wherever, what we're doing here is we're saying, okay, that's fine, go ahead, but hey, don't break this zone. And the way that we can give them the math to understand what we mean by breaking this zone is to pick an element, which sometimes you don't have the element. Sometimes you have to pick an arbitrary size. But you get the idea by looking at this, I trust, that what I've done is I've used the 1992 graphic as sort of an amount of space which is reasonable. And it's an element which, if they have the logo file, they can determine quite quickly for themselves, okay, if I just grab this and duplicate it, I can use it to measure the space around this logo to keep the safety according to the standard guidelines. So please leave a width equal to the 1992 element of clear space around the logo to preserve its shape and integrity. Now, typography is pretty straightforward and self-explanatory. We're just going to help them understand our idea behind the typography. And our idea is, please use electrolyze for headlines, feature copy, or offer copy details. But you can be as detailed with this as you want. I just find that this is sufficient. We've chosen the font Gotham as the body copy font. It's a nice sort of clean font with not huge X height, or rather with a good X height and not huge ascender and descenders was what I meant to say. But anyway, so it's a good font that is readable and it holds up on small and large applications alike. So please use Gotham for body copy and optionally for headlines. And the final page of the style guide, and this doesn't have to be the final page. Again, you could put a contact page, and there are brand style guides that are hundreds of pages. Well, we don't need that because this is not a national brand and this is not a logo that has, you know, several hundred different applications and different rules about it. But I have seen style guides and had to read style guides in my 32 years that have been monumental. And so anyway, we don't need that. So our last page in this case is simply going to be, hey, by the way, this style guide is great, but you obviously need logos. So in the logo kit that you'll receive, or that we assume you have received, includes these following files. So we let them know that there's a CMYK set of files, four of them in this case. There's an RGB set of files that happens to be more than four. That's the RGB version, which may get used on the web and it may get used elsewhere. And the spot color, we have three files for that. And so once again, graphic designers will understand what this information means. And now we've given them a nice round presentation called the Greenlight Window Fashions Logo Style Guide that's going to help them understand how to use the logo. Okay, so we've basically locked this down entirely as a good foundation for a brand. It's not a whole brand yet. The style guide really just tells us how the logo behaves and what to do with that. Building an entire brand around this is the next steps that may happen over the next 2 to 3 years. But the style guide for the logo is a good stake in the ground, a good place to begin, and now we have that. So the next thing that we're going to do is prepare the logo kit, because now we have to actually send out these logo files to our client, who may then subsequently send them to somebody else. But these logos will also be used by us. So if I'm doing a design job for John, 2 months from now, I'm going to grab this same logo, obviously, that I've used. And so I've got to know which one I'm using, even though I can open them and look at them. I don't want to have to do that. So I'm going to build a good file system for the logo kit, which will be something that is helpful to me, but also helpful to somebody else in the same way that the style guide is. So let's get into that in the next video lesson, and I'll show you how to start building out all these files for final delivery to client. Okay, so that's a little taste of what you'll see on the Udemy course, Logo Design Theory and Application Bootcamp. So hopefully you thought that was cool. I did, and I enjoyed the whole course. Creating it was a lot of fun, and it was a ton of work. And so I'd really appreciate seeing you there, and hopefully you check out my course and keep checking out YouTube channels. This will never stop. They'll keep these coming, you know, all the time. So I will see you back here again soon. And until next time, you stay classy, and I'll catch you again soon. Goodbye.